IT Idiots would like to thank UK2.net for sponsoring the show, the UK's largest provider of web hosting, providing the content and bandwidth distribution for this show.
Okay, welcome to episode 9 of Dude, we're trying to record. Okay, play later. Welcome to episode 9 of IT Idiots. My name's Nicholas Hill, and I'm joined as usual by our nimwit, Nicky Curtis.
Hello.
And our other nimwit, Shabby Beckley.
Hi.
So this week we're going to be looking at the second part of
Group Policy. Policy,
and we're going to be continuing on, I guess, from where we left off last week.
Yeah.
And funny enough, it really looks as if none of us have changed for a week.
No, it's obviously a different week, because I wasn't wearing a hat last week.
Oh, okay, mm-hmm. That's how we tell the two apart,
really.
Okay. Nothing to do with back-to-back back,
no,
coming.
Exactly.
Okay, lovely. Okay, so I guess in the past week, what have people been up to? You've been following up on your... are your games consoles? You haven't played Oblivion yet, dude.
No, I've just bought it.
Oh, okay.
Have you bought it?
Yeah.
Cool.
I haven't really.
You haven't, no. You're making stuff up, aren't you?
Just he's trying to fend his boredom issue.
That's
very
boring.
Enough. He buys games.
Or live. Or making stuff up.
Okay. Well, I thought I'd just nothing up. And
yes, nothing. Yeah. You should buy the Brain Game. I don't know if you guys have seen the Brain Game. Brain age thing.
Yeah.
I'm currently averaging a mental age of 68.
And that's not good. That's I not thought, good. Is that it's old and white?
I tried,
it's not. It's slow and...
I tried after a night out and I got 80. Which is pretty good. But you know, older and wiser.
Absolutely. But I don't think it works that way.
No.
Okay. So, I've been up to nothing in the past. No, that's not true, actually. I bought coffee this week.
You bought coffee. And
I bought coffee.
And kept on going about high definition cameras all week.
Oh, high definition cameras. Dad, if you're watching, you know, your poor son, who's the baker.
You know, I mean, we could add so much with...
Mrs. Curtis, you're minted.
You could read the Starbucks ingredients and everything.
Everything. Oh, it would be so great. Mrs. Curtis, we need a high-definition camera.
Okay, we need to send plasma off, I think.
Yeah, I'll tell you. We do this every week to get the alignment sorted. But, okay, so I think we're just going to jump straight into some more group policy.
Some group policy, yeah. So let's just... recap on what we did last week, and I'll start off by having a look at the first domain controller we've got. So I'm still looking at the plasma. Having a look at the first domain controller that's situated in Surbiton.
Okay.
And what we did last week was we talked about starting to restrict some of our users. So we went into group policy objects, and we created a couple of group policies, or three it looks like. One was to disable the command prompt, one was to disable the run command, one was to run a logon script. And we talked about linking and group policy inheritance. Also talked about blocking and override as well, didn't we? So we did quite a lot of the group policy processing,
mm-hmm.
quite a lot of it. So now what we can do is actually go a little bit further into the group policy and have a look at some of the settings.
Okay, actually configuring up a group policy rather than just giving them names.
Well, unfortunately, yeah, it's not clever enough to say disable run command. Only if it was like that. Disable run command in USB drives, it doesn't really work.
Like my Mac.
Maybe Vista would do. Probably the Mac would do that.
I said the Mac probably just automatically just do that.
So they don't have a run command, I suppose, anyway, do they?
Yeah, exactly. So that's why.
So you get by Mac, no run
command. No run commands have to disable.
Okay, so let's have a look at the group policy. And the first one we're going to go with is the one that's disable run command. Well, we'll ignore that. That didn't happen. But don't edit it, because it's real world.
It is real world.
However good GPMC is, it was written by
Microsoft,
yeah. And they don't have such a good track record with some of their OMC consoles. Anyway, I've got to deal with the best I have. So, disable run command. Now, when I click on disable run command on the left-hand side pane, over on the right-hand side, let's just go through the information we're seeing here.
Mm-hmm.
It's showing us who it's linked to. So it's linked to locations.
Yeah.
So, you know, we talked about last week if Shabby created a policy and you both linked to it, what Shabby could do is have a look at that policy and he could say, well, no, Ashford is linked to that, I better give him a call.
Or just ignore the issue.
Or just unlink it. I say, what can I do to them? Security filtering. These are the people who are actually going to be affected by that policy.
Okay.
So what it's really saying is everyone underneath locations, as long as they're an authenticated user, mm-hmm. is going to be affected by that policy. And who's an authenticated user?
Anyone on our domain.
Anyone who's logged on. Yeah. So that's basically saying everyone.
Everyone.
But what you can actually do there is you can use something called group policy filtering. Do you know last week I said, what about insertion? I don't want the HR people to have a run command.
Mm-hmm.
And we came up with, the best idea, the best way of dealing with that is to create a sub
two
and sort of link it lower down.
Yeah.
What we could have done is we could have linked it higher up and we could have removed authenticated users from there and added in the HR people.
Because the HR group, and we would have just added the HR group in.
So although it was linked to Surbiton, they haven't, or the non-HR people don't have the rights to read it. So they can't process it. And that's called group policy filtering. A little bit more hassle to deal with in terms of troubleshooting the thing, as you can imagine. When you're designing your AU structure, you try not to design filtering. Because normally you're using filtering because you're
solve a problem later on.
Yeah, I mean, there are a few exceptions, but there are a few cases where filtering is the only way forward.
Okay. You know.
Okay, so that's authenticated users. Now, WMI filtering, Windows Management Instrumentation, is what that stands for.
Okay.
Now, do you guys know much about WMI? You might as a programmer.
No, not at all.
Okay, so the way I'd simply describe WMI at the moment is it's just an information repository. It's like a local database.
Mm-hmm.
Again, not an exactly correct description, but it would do. So it's like a database. What does that contain? It contains information about that machine.
Contains tables and records.
Yeah, it's like all classes and attributes, as they call them now.
Oh,
you know, okay. So with WMI, you can actually have a look at your WMI layer by running up WebM test, WBEM test, all one word. And you can actually have a look through it. It's not very exciting. And it uses WQL Windows Query Language.
Oh, okay.
It's basically an information repository. If you look back at all machines, XP 2000, 2003, they store information in slightly different areas. So what they've decided to do is implement WMI, which sort of stores that in a hierarchical fashion, which is not related to the machine.
So it allows you to see the information and it extracts the information, even though it's stored in slightly different ways, and allows you to see that in a uniform way?
Well, what it actually does is there's a service that runs it, it's called Windows Management, and it queries the underlying layers and builds up a controlled hierarchy based on that, and it's actually controlled by the ISO as well. Now, the idea being, if you wrote a program in, say, portable language, I'm not much of a developer, so I'm going to say Java, and that Java program queried Windows Management to give you the IP address of that machine.
8 minutes later, it'd come back with an answer.
Okay, if it was to write that, that will work on any machine that supports Windows Management. Unix machines support them.
Okay.
So it makes it very, very portable. It's a very, very portable way of getting information. And because I deal with systems management a lot, I'm obviously quite involved in that area.
Okay.
Okay, so what can we do with WMI filtering? What I could do is I could link this policy to an organization unit and say, hang on, don't run it unless the result set of that WMI filter is true for you.
Okay.
Give you an example. What I could say is, this group policy is going to install Office 2000 as long as your WMI filter says you've got more than 200 megabit space.
Ah, so really you can go down to a very finite level.
You can do,
So rather than create problems, some really quite simple sort of checks.
Yeah, I mean,
really clever.
What I would say is it will complicate things again.
Mm-hmm.
Do people use it? Yeah, you can use it.
But it's there to be used if you need it to.
So it does complicate things. Sometimes too many people see these features and they find a reason to use them.
Right.
And normally they stay away.
Curtis being one.
Yeah, well, right. another thing I say about WMI filtering, if I was to roll out Office 2000 to the clients in Ashford and base it on that WMI filter, your group policy gets applied at roughly 2 hour intervals.
Mm-hmm.
That group policy goes down to the client machine, he evaluates, have I got 200 meg? Nah. Next 2 hours, have I got 200 meg? Nah. And he's constantly re-evaluating that all the time. Whereas other ways to deploy applications like SMS, what they do is they look at your inventory, based upon that, they target you at that point. So there's no localized processing.
But the reverse is also true then, I guess, because if it goes down and says, yeah, he's got space, by the time it comes back, if I've just downloaded IT Idiots...
Exactly.
I've just run out of disk space.
It's a fairly large file size, isn't it? It's a fairly big one.
But good quality.
Yeah, and quantity.
Nice.
Lots of bits. Okay, that was really geeky, wasn't it? Right, so disable run command. So that's really the scope tab on it.
Okay.
So I would say generally, at least 90% of the policies I create are going to be left like that and that.
Okay.
Okay.
Don't complicate it for the sake of complicating it.
Exactly, yeah. Details next. Right, so the domain that it's been created in ad.itidiots.com,
mm-hmm.
and GPO status here we can see is enabled. Now at this point what we can do is disable the policy, or we can disable certain sections of the policy. Now I'll talk about that in just a second. But imagine this scenario, we've created the policy, we've linked it to an OU, and it's all going a little bit wrong. Users are phoning up, complaining, what can I do? Quickly go in there and disable it, and then you can work on it. So you'd have to delete it or something. You could unlink it as well. That would be another way of doing it. Okay. But it might be linked to 10,000 places, in which case it'd be quicker to right-click there once rather than go around it 10,000 times. But you could actually...
It depends how quick we are.
It does depend how quick you are.
Have you noticed that up there, dude? It's off the camera. But if you look up just above Shabby, you see it. It's all the Damocles.
Is that anything to do with Xena?
Might be.
Right, so GPA settings enabled. Let's just cancel out of that one. Settings. This is an HTML view of all the settings that we've configured in the policy. Again, we didn't have this in 2000, but it's... I'll show you a policy in a minute, and they're massive. There's actually loads of stuff you can do with that. And this is a really nice way of just having a look at your policy and just finding out what's configured and what's been left alone. Now, great for documentation.
Would that, I mean, you'd create that document policy first, wouldn't you? It'd all be documents, and then you'd implement it based on what had been designed.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a nice way of checking to make sure the two still balance up, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, what I do in a group policy design is normally lead a 1 or 2 day workshop to get the settings off the customer and then implement them. And then as you go through various iterations, it constantly changes as people realise, oh, no, I don't want to do that to my users, I don't want to do this.
That looks like a lot of work.
And as you're changing, this provides a great report right at the end of it to show you what you finally did.
In the real world, do they ever come up with all these and then realise, oh, but that's going to stop me being able to download this and put it onto my USB drive and take it home?
Exactly. Yeah, it's happening to me at the moment.
Really?
With the USB drive. They don't want USB drives and they've suddenly realised, yeah, and maybe they do.
Yeah.
Normally it's down to a manager working somewhere.
Who needs to take their IT idiots home to watch it?
Or they've got their Shuffle device and it's really important that they update their music.
Gotcha.
Very, really important. Right. You just love managers. So that's
I do actually.
Look at the setting.
Managers hold a good important role within the company, you know.
Too many of them, I say. Right, delegation. The delegation tab is people who can administer this policy. They can go in and modify the settings.
Okay. What are we going to modify?
I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going through them. Lots of these things. I've got to say, group policies, I would say, one of the most important things about AD. A lot of my time now I spent going into companies that have introduced AD maybe about 3 years ago.
Badly?
Well, not so much badly. They've just upgraded an NT4 domain, and all they end up with is an Active Directory domain behaving exactly like the NT4 domain.
Right.
They're not implementing OUs.
They're not taking advantage of any of the features that are there.
Not at all. Not at all.
So this is a hot topic at the moment, then? Or it has been an ongoing hot topic?
It's always been a hot topic. People are now realising the power of group policy. They really, really are. Okay, so that's looking at some of the settings. Now, let's have a look at the actual settings of the group policy now. Now, if I right-click on the group policy, I can go to Edit. And you may not have appropriate rights to do that. Okay, so group policy object editor, you can see from there, has gone a little bit funny for the moment.
It hasn't gone funny.
We're ignore that. It should be able to handle with loading two up. Right, edit. Don't give me no crap. Right, so I'm going to close all of these down and let's
reboot that machine.
I'm not going to reboot it. It'll take ages.
No, but Shabby can tell us some of the benefits he's been finding from group policy.
Group policy. I should lock down your machine, actually. Minimise the support. That worries me. Well, it cannot find the file specified. You're going to right-click.
I don't have any of these problems on my Mac.
No, nor do I. Right, what I'm going to do, I am running this, as you probably know, in a VMware environment, and this machine's struggling a little bit at the moment. I don't know if that's causing the problem, but I haven't had that problem before in reality.
Yeah.
You know. So what I'm going to do...
stuff that you've set up, then.
What I'm going to do is disable run commander. Let's create another one.
Okay.
And let's see if it's going to allow me to edit that one.
An underbar disable run command.
When I'm testing group policies, always start with underscore. They show up in the top of the list.
Yeah.
There's also the way of telling it it's a testing one.
Yeah.
Right, so group policy. There's two sections to the group policy, two distinct sections to the group policy. We've got computer settings and user settings.
Okay.
Now, if we just have a quick peek at some of the settings, not much underneath there.
It's interesting. Software, Windows.
But, I mean, just have a look.
It's going to be huge.
It's massive, you know, and I haven't even open up admin templates, and you go to Windows components, and you've got all the Windows components, Internet Explorer, you can see.
So somebody's really sat down and worked and thoroughly thought this through and laid it all out.
Some of it, yeah. Yeah, of that. Now, all of this is documented in... It's another thing that surprises me, people's lack in the real world, their lack of knowledge about help files and how useful they are. It's almost like saying, you know, I'm too important to use a help file. But this will really help you out. It's called system.chm, and that's just Microsoft help files or .chms. And pretty much all of your group policy settings are documented in here. So you've got your computer settings, and you've got your user settings underneath here.
Nice.
Okay. Now, what I'm going to do is a little bit of drawing.
Just when my dad starts to bite his nails.
I'm not so happy about the drawing.
No, he feels like he could maybe put a bit more effort into them.
Well, I could put more effort and do preparation of slides and everything, but I feel like it's nice.
It's real. This is real world.
I do get the point, but I do have a job as well.
Yeah.
You know.
It's right, we've barred his IP anyway.
No, all the feedback I take on board. Okay, so group policy. Let's have a look at the RAD design. The screen capture software is slightly slowing down. See, I think this does the job. I don't think you need this to be any nicer.
Yeah, but those two lines didn't join up at the top.
Okay, what we've got is we've got locations. And underneath that, again, you can refer to the network diagram, our Active Directory structure, which is available on the website.
itidiots.com.
itidiots.com. Surbiton, Ashford. Etc. I'm going to end that.
Yeah.
Okay, next one, we've got workstations. And underneath that, we've got laptops. Again, I know I'm not putting full words here, but you're okay. I think people will understand that, don't they?
Well, they're listening to you.
Desktops.
No, that's good.
Exactly. I like that. Now, our group policy contains two sections. Now, let's say I've got a user in Surbiton there.
Mm-hmm.
That user is Nikki. Mm-hmm. Here's my workstation. It's there. I'm going to put W for workstation. Now, I'm going to create a group policy. We've seen the group policy, there's two sections. There's a computer configuration setting and a user configuration setting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, things like disable run command, it's a bit of an art, and you'll get used to it. It's just total practice on group policies and finding out what these bloody settings are. Okay, disabling run command is something you do to a user. You mm-hmm. remove a run command from a user. So that setting, where's my pen, is actually under user configuration. Disable run. Whereas certain settings are for computers. I'll give you an example. I can't think of any at the moment.
There must be loads.
There's a few, but a lot of the time you just spend in user configuration. Okay, computer configuration, I want to control the size of your event logs.
Yeah, that's not a user specific.
It's not related to what your user logs onto it. It's the computer. That computer's always going to have those event logs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's a good one. I like that one.
Logs.
Right, so I've created a group policy. That group policy says disable run command. Now, if I link that group policy, and this is where your dad might have a point because it's going to get a little bit messy here. If I link that group policy to there, what's it going to do to that guy there, Nikki? So Nikki logs on, so there's my user account, logs on to that workstation. I've got a group policy. Here's the group policy. It's that one there, and it's going to disable the run command.
So you want me to use the run command?
Well, that's it. Again, what I would expect someone, you know, for when you first look at it.
Yeah.
If you got it, Nick.
I can't make out head or tail from that diagram. It's just rubbish.
What we're trying to say is that group policy up in the top, it's got two sections, user configuration, disable run. So we linked it to there. All of the users underneath there will not have a run command.
Yeah.
Now, there's no users under there. I'm over there. I'm in Surbiton there. But that's fine. No. Okay. So... if I link that policy to that, it will not have an effect to disable the run command for users. So, I want to link that down to that, to Surbiton.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, the group policy there, it's got computer configuration. Your event log size is 8 megabytes, let's say. If I link it to there, it's not going to have any effect on any computers. It's only computers underneath that OU and users underneath that OU. So, you know, I haven't seen this written down in Microsoft books, but I kind of always do this because of that. My group policies either have computer settings or user settings.
And do you prefix them?
No.
Okay.
But you could prefix them. Yeah, that's not a bad idea.
Let's not poo-poo my ideas.
I So I wanted to say no really aggressively at you.
All summer.
No, generic coffee. Other coffees available.
Right. So, disable run command. Pop into active directory. I don't need that anymore, do I? It's that lovely people. Right, and what we're going to do is disable the run command. Right, right click on the
group policy. We're going to disable a run command for a computer.
For. But stop playing the role of shabby.
Okay.
So it's
I'm just trying to prompt him into coming up with some ideas.
So obviously that policy I created last week, disable run command, is broken.
Yeah.
I think it's probably a removal of USB drive issue again.
I think so.
Okay, which shabby did. Right, so let's go to that group policy and edit.
Mm. I like that one anyway.
Yeah, it's got an underscore. Yeah. It's good, it's trendy. Admin templates. Open this up. Now, as I say, it's just going to take a little while to get used to where all these settings are. You know, you don't need to learn the parrot fashion. But I would say most of the user restriction stuff are user-based, and they're all underneath admin templates. Okay, it's all listed under admin templates.
Right.
Now, what I always do is sort of ask yourself, we want to disable the run command, don't we?
Okay.
So would it be under that? Would it be under start menu and taskbar, desktop control? Well, I would guess start menu and taskbar.
Yeah, but we know these things.
This is true.
I mean, Shabby wouldn't know that. He would have to look through all of them.
Again, what you could do, Shabby, could look in the CHM file, and the CHM file will tell you the location. Okay, so it tells you. So, let's double-click on remove run command. Let's enable it. Right, now it's a little bit weird, so you always got to read it back to yourself. I'm enabling the removal of the run command.
It makes perfect sense. It
makes absolute sense. So I'm enabling the removal of the run command. Let's go to explain that. And again, you can read that. Obviously not in your video format you're looking at.
Well, they will be able to.
Will they?
Yeah.
Not in your iPod though.
No.
But what about if I...
I can zoom that in.
What about if I put it over there?
Right, well then...
Okay. Right, what's the point? Yeah, you can read through that, so I'll go to the documentation.
Once you select the remove run menu and enable, do you press OK or do you press apply?
Well, apply just... let's actually go through that now. Let's enable that remove run command. If I click on OK, that's applying it and closing
the box.
However, what I might do is just say, I'm going to apply that. It's now taken effect and it's left me in that box.
Yeah, okay. I mean, I quite often use that to then go and check something. I mean, I appreciate in this case scenario, you might
this
not,
is quite simple,
but it's sometimes a very useful thing to apply something, go and check to make sure it's doing what you want to do, and once you've checked it and approved it, you can then just OK it.
Yeah.
But I get asked from people, what's the difference between apply and OK? And I think, you've just done a service. You're stupid.
Right, so remove run command from start menu has been enabled, so that's okay on that.
Okay.
Now the group policy management console, let's sort of follow through this console all the way through, because I think this is a great tool, which again, not many people pay that much notice of. Right, disable run command, underbar, that one.
Yeah.
Look in settings. Now you saw how many settings we had in that policy. Imagine you begin that policy and said, okay, what are the settings in there? You'd have to go through every single setting, you know, to find out what was going on. Whereas in here, we can see the only things that have been configured. We can see user configuration, remove run command has been enabled.
So it's basically generates a document for you, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And you can print that, I take it.
Yeah, you can right-click and save it.
Oh.
You know, it's just an HTML file.
It's basically self-documenting, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's brilliant.
It's got you get a little macro to turn it into a table, and then you save stuff in the afternoon.
Turn it to HTML, post it up on your company website.
Okay, so that's looking at disable run command. What else can I show you here? Well, notice this policy doesn't contain any computer settings.
No.
And for the reasons I said before, I'm going to keep them separate.
Yeah.
So best practice is to go into the details of that policy and just say GPO status, computer configuration settings disabled.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's just good practice.
So basically all we're looking at is user-based settings.
So if I log on as, let's put a user in Dudley.
Dudley? No, we haven't got any computers in Dudley. It's Ashley.
Oh, we've got the
There's two, isn't there? That's right. Zeroskowski, I think, was the name.
Dudley was an open source.
Yeah, well, one bad thing about Group Policy Management Console is when you're working with it, you constantly get confused with Active Directory users and computers. And people are trying to use it.
In the same way.
I mean, what you can do is just load up an MMC and add both the snap-ins into it. That'd be an easy way, but it still confuses me. I'm quite a simple guy.
A simple needs.
Yep.
Ba-da-da-bum. So, Shabby, any thoughts on this? Anything you want to contribute?
Look, guys, I don't know why you're watching me do that for, because I've just got off on one there, so I think you should leave that in. Nicky, go off on one.
Yeah.
Learning strange tools. Okay, so what I'm doing is just making sure there's a user in Ashford we can use for testing. Ashford, Nicholas Hill. I'm going to create another user, and we'll call this one _ash test. And again, it's always nice and make sure your test accounts are always at the top of the list. Got to give it a password. But you can't guess what that is.
No, but I bet you there's some software out there that can detect the speed and the...
Oh, there is, isn't there?
There is, isn't there?
Well, my dyslexic typing, though.
Yeah, I was going to say all the...
Right, so guys, if I was to log on as Ashford Test to Windows XP, we're expecting not to see a run command, yeah? Agreed?
I don't think so.
Well, thank you for that. Well, what haven't I done, Shabby?
Hasn't done a replication.
Not quite.
Oh, really?
I haven't done something.
Oh, no, you haven't. Yeah.
I haven't linked it to the bloody thing.
Sorry. Yeah, I thought that had been done.
Yeah, so.
Sorry.
Let's go to disable run command. And what I'm going to do is go to locations, and I'm actually going to link it to the locations I use.
Yeah, so it's all the way down.
So I don't want anyone, no matter if you're in Ashford, Dudley, or Surbiton, I don't want you to have a run command. I'm just going to delete this one. This is one I created last week.
Yeah.
Just to tidy up a bit.
The Mankey one.
Manky one, yeah. So let's delete on that. And what we can do is we know the console. We can check by going into Dudley and going to Group Policy Inheritance. We can see that the disable run command's in there, so we know it's going to inherit down again.
Okay.
Okay. Now, again, I don't want to waste your time forcing replication in this episode.
No.
So what I'm going to do is we learnt from last week's episode that the group policies by default would be focused on the PVC emulator.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to test on a client machine that's in the same Active Directory site as that PVC emulator.
Which is Surbiton.
Which is Surbiton, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, I apologise for the technical difficulties experienced there, but I found that a nice cup of English tea really soothed the occasion.
Well, so you soothed your occasion while I was bloody troubleshooting.
Yeah, but I put it down.
How long was that? 2 hours?
I put it down basically to the fact that, again, no preparation and he just wasn't looking up.
Well, we're trying to do as much ad-libbing as possible. I think that's very much what I want to do, not script the thing.
Okay.
And it will go wrong occasionally, but this time, it's probably worth talking about.
Yeah, I think it is, yeah.
Experiencing file corruption on the domain controller, the way I sort of diagnosed that was having a look at, well, we created the group policy, and I was wondering, well, why is the XP client machine, why is it not receiving this policy? Had a look in the event log on the XP client machine, and there was loads of errors moaning about the group policy template files being corrupted.
You are capturing this, by the way, aren't you?
I'm not capturing this, but I will do when it becomes important, so remind me in a second. Okay. In fact, now's a good time to start capturing.
And show you what I mean.
And show you what I mean, yeah. We might have to talk for a little bit, guys.
Okay. Well, oh, yeah, no, actually... Basically, what happened was we'd been off air for about an hour and a half, roughly that, and it was about 10 minutes to diagnose the problem, and about 1 hour, 20 minutes, for Nicky to come up with a plausible excuse as to why it wasn't his fault.
No, but rebooting
was... But no.
Right, 20, what are we doing? 15 frames, 10 frames we're doing, 10 frames, no sound, and do you want to overwrite the last one?
No.
Oh, I think it auto-increments from that.
You've got it to start.
I want it on, we're episode 9 now, aren't we?
Yes.
Right, so, sorry guys.
Okay, so...
Right.
Where were we?
So, it was on the XP machine, and I was talking about the event logs. I'm not going to show you, actually, I'm excited. But it was those errors, and it was mainly about corruption. Now, unfortunately, we didn't have any backups. Now, the Group Policy Management Console, perhaps we ought to round up today with backing up our policies. We didn't have any backups of the domain controller policy or the default domain policy, which are the really, really important policies.
Okay.
What we should have done is obviously back those up, but luckily we haven't made any changes to those.
We haven't created anything.
No, they're there by default, so you can probably see the last thing I ran. There you go, troubleshooting. It was DC GPO fix.
Okay, and gets me out of a lot of trouble, that does.
Yeah, and what DC GPO fix does is it basically sets your default domain controller policy and your domain controller policy back to the state they are in after installation.
Which
is why it's so important that you have backups if you've modified them. Because, I mean, the next step would be to DCO GPO fix them and then restore over the top,
so you've got a nice clean base to start from.
Exactly. Gotcha. Yeah, I'm not sure what file corruption happened. It's on the USB drive, this thing. Everything's all up.
Touch it.
Seven last week, five this week. Virtual machines are running from that at the moment. It's 5400 speed. I don't think that's the bottleneck.
So again, if anyone wants to sponsor the show by providing high-end spec hardware,
some faster ones, we'd do a better job, honestly.
We would try.
Yeah, so it's all running on that, and the laptop's, it's got a gig and a half, it's fairly reasonable spec, so yeah. I think it's sent to do with just VMware.
I think a faster hard drive can do it.
I think so as well. Right, exit. I don't know, I don't know if it's the bottleneck or not.
I think it is.
Anyway, I suppose we better test it. What I've done is, you might spot a few changes since I've been deleting and recreating things, but let's just quickly recap where I'm at. We've got this group policy called disable run command. Let's just check to see what settings are in it. So we can look at the settings tab, and we can see remove run command's actually on there, so that looks all good. Mm-hmm. Let's find out where it's linked to by going to the scope tab. It's linked to the locations OU, which is this one up on here. Okay, so we can now see that everyone who's got a user account, remember because it's a user setting, who's got a user account underneath the locations is going to be processing that policy.
Lovely.
Okay, let's just ignore that for a second.
So I think we were going to go and try and see whether we could actually see that that policy had actually been implemented, weren't we?
We were indeed, yeah.
It's a good job we didn't keep the dialogue open of apply before doing OK.
Yeah, one of the weird things about when you create a group policy, actually, a little bit of waffle here, is when I first came across it, you can edit it. Let's say we want to make some modifications to it. And you think, well, where's the OK button? Where's the apply button? There isn't one. You literally make your settings and then you close it. And that's good enough.
Wow.
But it was a little bit scary.
It was the first time.
Okay, so we're going to disable run command for everyone in locations. Let's just remind ourselves on the Active Directory structure.
Mm-hmm.
Little shortcut to get to Active Directory using computers is to do start run dsa.msc, which is the snap-in for the MMC console. Mm-hmm. And if you look under Ashford, I've got underscore ash test, Nicholas Hill, I don't know what other users I've got. Oh, Shabby, we disabled you.
Yeah, we covered why that was.
We disabled you. Oh no, that's my dream. We disabled your account in reality.
Right, so.
Let's just enable that whilst we're here. Anyway, so what I'm going to do is log on as Ash Test. Any one of those users will be affected. Let's flick over to the XP machine and log on as Ash Test. It's almost like I've done that before, isn't it? And log on. So it said applying your personal settings there very, very quickly, and at that point, that's when it's reading the policy.
Okay.
Now, that user policy will be refreshed. Well, it's refreshed when the user logs on, so that's when it's applied. And it's refreshed at a 90-minute plus a randomised 30-minute offset.
Okay.
It's every 90 to 120 minutes it's going to refresh. Okay. So if someone in the back room was making a modification to that policy, let's say they disabled control panel, within 2 hours that would have rolled out.
Okay, you guaranteed that it was into it, or is that based on the...
Based on clients updating and based on the fact that the group policy is actually replicated down to the DC that they're using.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay, so, God, how can we talk when it's going to be a run command?
Can you alter that 2-hour setting from the DC?
You can alter that 2-hour setting, you can, yeah. I generally think that 2 hours is sort of reasonable enough, and I don't generally play around with things.
Reasonable question.
Yeah, it's a good question, yeah. DCs, actually, domain controllers, they update every 5 minutes.
Okay.
A lot more frequently. But if you think about where they're updating from themselves, because they're a domain controller, so it's easy for them to update frequently.
Sure.
To be honest, in a well-designed network, your group policy pretty much is static. It's designed static and left alone. Well, static and left alone is pretty much the same thing. Look, it's a run command. Aren't you excited?
Start.
Start. Now, unfortunately, Shabby probably wouldn't know where the run command was anyway in the first place.
Command prompt.
But, no, the run command was there. Mm. I didn't disable the command prompt. I disabled the run
start
command.
Run.
Okay, so we can see the run command is.
So I can still do lots of damage from a command prompt.
You can still do lots of damage, yeah, you still can. Now,
but it's proved the point of what we're trying to actually do.
It has proved, yeah. So
eventually.
We just logged in as this Ash Test guy who's under Ashford. and they were obviously affected by the group policy that's linked to the parent OU locations. Right, now what I'm going to do is something a little bit weird, and I can't think of a good scenario when you'll use this, but it's really just to prove the point.
Yeah.
Right, let's create a new group policy. This one's called enable run command. Now when you create a group policy, if you have a look at all the settings in the group policy, they are actually set to the value of not configured,
right,
which basically means leave it alone. So if someone's made a reg edit on the client machine, leave it alone. That's what it means, is just leave it how it is.
Okay.
It doesn't mean reset to default, means leave it how it is. So this group policy, everything at the moment is leave
as
it how it
is. Yeah.
Now what I want to do is enable the run command on this one. Okay, let's say we've got a default policy that's going to disable the run command for everyone, but I want these guys to have a run command, so I'm going to put it back.
Ah, okay.
Now, I think when you see the demo, it'll become clear, because I'm not too happy with my explanation at the moment. So, remove run command. What about if we do that?
It's going to enable the ability to run it.
Yeah, now, it's sort of like a double negative, isn't it? Or, yeah, it's a double negative. And if you look into it, I spent hours thinking about this, it doesn't actually work truly as a double negative, if you think about it.
It doesn't. I was going to use double negative earlier, but I actually figured that in several minutes, well, several seconds.
Several seconds.
True, yeah.
Okay, so if we disable the removal of the run command, you can consider that as enabling the run command.
Yeah, okay.
So let's click on OK there. Now what I'm going to do with that policy is go down to Surbiton, and I want users in Surbiton to have a run, or people in the Surbiton branch to have a run command.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to put that there. So if I've got a user account directly underneath Surbiton there,
yeah,
and whilst I'm talking about it, let's just create that user. So when I have a user account who logs on directly underneath that OU, what's their effective policy setting going to be? Because can you see the issue they've got? It's one policy saying take it away, and one of them saying put it back.
So one of them must take precedent.
Yeah, there's a policy processing order. And what I always think about it is quite simple, it's top to bottom. So you process the top policies and you work closer to where your object is in Active Directory. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create another user here. I forgot my password, so serve test. God, do you remember Suburban Commando?
No.
It was good. It had that wrestler guy in it, didn't it?
What are you talking about? Oh my god, Hulk Hogan.
Hulk Hogan, yeah. That's like your best film, Shelley. Right, I've just got serve test. Password. I should stop banging on the keyboard so now, should I?
Ew. It says real-time use.
Right, so that's Surbiton. Let's go back to Group Policy Management and just have a look at Surbiton Group Policy Inheritance. Now, what we can see is these are the group policies that are going to affect that user, and this is the processing order. Now, the way they represent it is they represent it in precedence order, which is for idiots. Okay, it's an idiot's way of describing it. It makes sense.
Mm.
They say number one's got highest priority, so the end result is you're going to have a run command.
Mm.
I like to think of it as the processing order. And what actually happens is that policy, will get applied first from top. So when Nikki logs on, or when that serve user logs on, it's going to disable their run command, and then it's going to enable it.
So it does actually get through doing that.
Yeah, it does do it.
Really?
It does do that, yeah. Okay. So I suppose we'd better prove that, wouldn't we? So this guy hasn't got a run command.
Should I get ready with another edit? Sorry, I couldn't resist that.
I am capturing this, aren't I? Yeah, it's going slow enough.
Go, 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 go. Don't tell you, high definition, it looks beautiful, dude.
Does it?
Yeah.
Have you thought about going into high def?
I have, I think, yeah.
It's just a money issue, isn't it?
It is.
So I guess if we're giving away lots of valuable content like this, someone might give it to us or something.
Well, yeah, I've asked once already this show, so just keep asking. People get so annoyed, they're just biased when it just shows up.
Okay, so let's log on to serve test. And what we're hoping here is this serve test user is going to have a run command. And I'm hoping a lot more than you guys are.
I'm sure you are.
I must admit, in reality, you just don't then get these problems with group policy. It is a pretty straightforward thing.
Is that because they're running on real servers?
Yeah, the fact they're running on real servers rather than seven machines running on a laptop, it's really got something to do with that. Of course, the first time you log on, it's setting up Internet Explorer. Let's quickly go to... Oh, look, there's a run command. Absolutely amazing.
That's great.
It is great, isn't it?
I love it.
Let's analyse that. Okay, so what happened is, disable run command, and then enable run command. So if I was to log in as a user under Dudley, am I going to have a run command?
Yeah.
I am.
Mm. No, you're not.
No, it's just going to run that one, isn't it?
Yeah. So okay, you're not going to have one.
If I log in as one in Ashford, I'm not. You can just look at the inheritance tab here.
Okay.
Again, you didn't get that without the GPMC. Can you see how useful this thing is?
Yeah.
Okay, underneath here, enable run command. So if I click on Surbiton, we can see it's going to do that one first, then that one.
That's sort of
exactly. So no one in everyone in Surbiton is going to have a run command, aren't they?
Dangerous, but it's
because that's first precedent, isn't it?
Yeah. Now again, you can think of it that way. My brain's so in tune with working the other way, and I think that's the way. It's the way it works. It's a processing order. If you think about this as a tree, the user's there, so that policy gets applied first, followed by that one, followed by that one. Again, if you buy me a whiteboard, I can do a really good job on demonstrating that as well.
We've asked for so much. I found that if
a packet of chewing gum wouldn't go amiss.
If somebody bought me a Porsche 911, I'd be able to get here quicker, which means be able to set up earlier. I mean, it's a never-ending thing.
But if you get a shabby Porsche 911, you won't get here quicker.
He preferably might not get here at all.
Right, what am I going to do now? Let's prove that, because, you know, you're just taking my word for it at the moment, really. Let's right-click on Surbiton, and let's delete that link.
Yeah, let's do that.
So what are we saying now? In Surbiton...
There is no... There's no.
What's going to happen if a user logs on the Surbiton?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to go back and take what's default at the top.
So it's going to go default the main...
location, and then disable your run command.
And it's going to disable. So user in Surbiton and not have a run command.
And then it stops, because we've taken anything else out at the lower level.
So, let's have a look. Run command. Still running. Why?
Because we haven't logged off and logged back on again, and it hasn't applied the policy.
Yeah, so, I mean, what we could do is we could log off and log back on again.
Was that right?
You could do that. Updates the policy. The other thing we could do is wait 2 hours. Because we're talking about the policy refresh.
Could we use SMS to force that?
Yeah, you could in a way, but the SMS job would get there.
About after 3 hours.
Yeah. So what we can do is... We can force it from the client.
Can we phone up every client and ask them to run a certain command?
You can run GP update. Again, in real-life networks, so many people say, can you force it? It's really not that relevant in a real-life network because, you know, things go through so much of the design process and testing. You don't make changes.
And you normally do all this, like roll it out over a weekend anywhere or downtime.
Exactly, yeah. So GP update is a tool we can use. This needs to be run from the client machine and that GP group policy update.
But that's either involved somebody walking there or
more
worryingly asking a user to type in sort of like several letters into a command prompt.
This is true. GP update, if I run it on its own, what it will do is do an incremental update of the policy.
Okay.
If you do a GP update /force, it does a full read in.
Okay.
Now there's certain policy settings which can only take effect on computer startup and certain policy settings that can only take effect on user logging on. And this will tell me if it needs to log me off or update me. So if I do a GP update force, what we're expecting to see, look, there's a run command there. Can I use it? Oh, didn't seem like anything happened there, did it?
No, but it's gone.
Shit, it's gone.
No.
Sorry, didn't really mean to square.
It wasn't a necessary
It wasn't necessary,
point.
Especially shit. That's not...
It's irrelevant, isn't it?
It's like saying damn. Darn.
Darnation.
It's gone. So, okay, that's good, isn't it? Right. So we proved that policy reversal thing works.
Yeah, that's quite good.
So what else? Let's spend the rest of time proving what we learned in the last episode, I think. I think that'd be a good way.
Why don't we let Shabby drive?
Because we've got to finish the podcast.
okay.
Right, so Surbiton. Oh, Surbiton users are not very happy now. They want their run command back, so what can we do?
We can recreate it.
We can block it.
Of course. Blocking everything.
It is blocking everything. But let's see if it... Let's
prove the point. That's what we're doing. We're proving.
We're proving. So, run command. Nothing there.
No, but...
Let's do a GP update on the thing.
Reboot required?
Not for a run command.
Not for a run command, sir. We saw that earlier.
What was that?
It didn't require a reboot.
Okay, that's great.
Right, so let's go start. And Jesus Christ, it's back again.
You gave us a clean tag. No, we're not clean, are we?
Jesus Christ is... there's nothing... I'm not going to go down that route because it's a little bit dubious, but... let's stop that. But yeah. No, I have no problem with him. I'm sure we'll get along fine if we met. You know, we've got a lot of things to go. Right, so, okay, I don't mean to be offending anyone, but let's just move on. Right, so that's a good thing, isn't it? Except it's all worked.
It's very good.
Right, I suppose the last thing to prove is no override, isn't it?
Of course.
Right, so the scenario now is, we've made a decision that no one's going to have a control panel. In fact, let's have some major restrictions locked down.
Let's lock everything down. Let's lock
it. Let's make it shabby proof. So,
what, prevent him from logging on?
Shabby proof policy. So this is so that users like Shabby can't screw the machine up. Okay, so you can't go into weird areas. So shabby proof policy. Let's right click on this and let's edit and go into it. I say all the restrictions. We'll talk about computer settings. I think another time. Yeah. I think grid policy is big enough to spend some time on it. I'm having quite a bit of fun.
It's great.
Okay, so let's go through user configuration, app in templates, and let's look at the restrictions you can have. So, control panel. Prohibit access to the control panel. Nah, you don't want a control panel. So you can't go in there and muck around now. So all the settings I make are all fixed.
That's quite a nice big one, actually, to do in one big hit.
Yeah, it is good. Now, some things you might want to leave in there, some
monitor, for example.
Yeah, and also, again, for any disabled users, accessibility options is quite important. You don't remove that, and I think there's some legal requirements in some countries that you actually leave it in there.
Really?
Yeah, so what you can do is you can actually name applets that you want removed, or vice versa, you know, name applets that you actually want on there. So that's quite a common one. You can take out lots of sort of dangerous stuff in there.
That sounds quite good.
Display. Well, remove display and control panel. I've wiped out the whole lot, so I don't need to worry about that.
No, it's all gone. Well, we can prove the point, can't we? And then you can just...
screensaver. I mean, I could configure a screensaver in here.
Yeah.
So that all the users, you know, who are affected by this policy, they're all going to have a screensaver. So many things. Standardised company bitmap. Regional language options. Can't be bothered with any of those anymore.
And again, these days with... sort of political correctness gone mad. You know, you stop people from having filthy screensavers and filthy wallpaper that just some people might find offensive.
Exactly.
So you can actually save your company a lawsuit and obviously override the policy for yourself.
Right, is there anything else I can do that's visual? I'm just looking for things that you might want to hide. My documents.
Well, I guess a lot of users might actually like it if you hit their documents and they can't do any work.
Well, anyway, you get the idea, guys. So have a look at the system.chm file, have a look at the settings in there, and if you like a look at them, you can restrict them.
Yeah.
Okay, so our shabby-proof policy at the moment, it isn't shabby-proof at all.
But it's the starting of a shabby-proof.
So what I want to do is, we've made the decision now, and I know this is a strange one, but this is proving a point. Everyone in the company should be running that policy.
Okay.
Absolutely everyone. So what does the policy do, guys, again? It removes the control panel, disables it. That's the only setting I put in then. So I link it to the domain. Who's that going to affect?
Everybody.
All the users under the domain. Okay, so all of them. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go to the XP machine. I've logged on as a certain user, and let's do a GP update for us. Now what I'm expecting, according to you guys, is that the control panel's going to go.
It won't be there.
But no, it won't.
I can tell from Mickey's face.
Has he applied it?
Okay. Well, let's have a look. Control panel's there. Is it going to say it's restricted? No, it's just going to load up about 2 miles an hour while my poor little laptop catches up. But you can see it quite clearly. I can get in there.
Yeah.
So, what went on there?
One thing went wrong.
Well, it did, because your answer was wrong.
No, but I agreed with...
But your first answer was wrong.
No, I didn't say it.
So I've applied it to there, and what did I just log on? I logged on this, give you a clue, user account was there.
Have we got a force override? No. Yes.
Well,
maybe.
What happened? The policy's there, isn't it? So let's have a look at...
We didn't create, we should have put it in the group policies, and then we should have It's all location, location, location.
Because Dudley's fine, they're going to run it.
Yeah.
Ashford's fine, they're going to run it. But Surbiton, they're not going to run it. In fact, they're not going to run anything.
I can't.
Because you blocked it.
Because I blocked it, yeah. So I just put a block in there. Mm. Now, that block was put in place for a reason. Now, I want that block in there. However, it's really, really important to us that everyone runs that policy. So that leads on to really the last thing I can show you, and that's...
Exclude.
Exclude?
Not exclude.
You're talking about shabby again, aren't
you? No. I want to exclude shabby.
What do we exclude? We're enforcing.
Enforce.
So we can enforce it. Straight away, enforce it.
Enforce it.
Again, look at the GPMC, how useful this is. And we go to group pos inheritance, you can see it's going to come through now.
So if we now switch back...
Go to there.
Wrap this baby up. Force.
GP update, force. Now, the control panel's not going to disappear behind the scenes, you know.
Windows wouldn't be that clever.
They wouldn't be that clever, but you shouldn't be able to click on any applets. So, what I'm going to do is let's delete the control panel open. Let's pop into the control panel here. And, bollocks. Didn't work.
Go back in again and you'll find that it did work.
It might be because the control panel was open already.
The control panel was open.
There we go.
Trust me.
I don't like that, you know. We have to edit that bit out.
That's okay.
So that's it. So that's showing you no override. That's showing you block inheritance and also the important thing, inheritance, what inheritance is actually all about.
Sure.
Okay. What are we doing for time?
I'd say we're about good, actually. I'd say you've done a good job.
I always do a good job.
Yeah, definitely happy with that. So...
Yeah, I was kind of hoping we'd get a bit more settings on that, but I think that was a good episode anyway, because it sort of proved what we talked about, but didn't really...
And backed it up and actually shown it.
And backed it up,
eventually.
I mean, the only thing I haven't shown is filtering. You know, it's a little bit messy. What I can actually just very quickly do is point you in the right direction. You guys can explore that. So if I only wanted certain users to run, let's say, the shabby proof policy... There's a couple of ways of doing it. What I can do is go to the shabby proof policy here. We can see authenticated users have got the ability to use it. Mm-hmm. You can remove from there and click on add and add in your users.
Sure.
So that's one way of doing it. This box is
actually... You can do groups as well of people, can't you?
Yeah, so what you'll end up doing is create a group of users. I mean, normally your users are all grouped up anyway.
Sure.
Okay, so that's part of your first stages of design. So you can group them up. Some people do a deny as well. So if it's just for one user, deny is not a very good thing to use, but you know there are exceptional cases where if you've got a million users who want to run this, but one, me, just give one deny,
sure.
Okay, that one person. You could argue put that one user in a single group and give that group, and that gives you easier growth. You could do that.
Okay.
But that's it, I'm done.
Thank you very much.
Cool.
So let's have a little recap on, I guess, medical issues, because... Well, we normally do. We normally have a little chat. Medical chat.
So. Yeah, I mean, all the advice that Shabby's been giving me over the... I mean, the whole rectal thermometer, that was fine. I almost lost it, actually. I put too much on it, I think.
Okay.
So that almost disappeared.
I was thinking more, how have you been getting on with your lice issue?
Lice issue's fine. It's doing fine. I think I'm largely okay.
I don't think I know where you're coming from on this, because where have I tried, son? Woke up in the morning... And, you know, people accuse me of being big-headed, I tell you. Dude, I'm sure it's nothing to do with that wonderful thing that was prescribed, but, yeah, I think you're going to need to do some research and come up with something for me.
You're just getting it on with the cream, aren't you, mate?
Something's going on there, so I just wanted to bring up some potential problems that we might need to tackle.
Oh, has anyone else suffered from that?
You've
been suffering from it? Yeah, I suppose. Is it a suffering thing or is it a good thing?
It's a suffering thing.
Tiger balm. You tried tiger balm? Tiger balm. chili sauce.
Okay.
Quite unusual to have an allergic reaction.
Is it?
Really?
Is it unknown?
Fairly.
Oh, but I am a bit of an oddball. We are basically...
We've run out of ingredients, haven't we?
The bottom line is... Nikki and I put so much preparation into this, and what we say to Shabby is, can you just take care of medical issues? He turns up with nothing, as per usual. Runs out, doesn't get something.
I mean, this is after being warned that he's boring.
He gets something, so he runs out to the shop to get something. We're filming two episodes, he knows this. He gets a drug for one.
For one, yeah.
And by the time Nikki's bodged
all the fixes and everything we do, you know, at this hour of the day, you're just not going to find a pharmacy that's open. So we're without drugs this week, or any sort of cure for any illnesses or ailments. So again, I put myself down and ridicule and humiliate myself. So on this note, I'm going to thank our sponsors. And we're back. And I think I'm going to wrap this up. What are we looking at coming? Oh, are we going to do ACP, UDP?
Well, we've got a couple of things to do now. I mean, group policy, I think what we covered is really much the processing, how it does. I mean, we could go through settings and talk about the settings, like disabling run command and stuff, but, you know, we'll be here all day, to be honest.
And we're trying to build up a viewing audience.
So I think we've got enough of an idea on what group policies can do.
So if somebody's got a specific question, start sending in questions, because we'd like to start answering some of these questions live.
But I think it's come apparent from today, actually, for me, that we need to do delegation at some point.
Okay.
And also we're going to definitely do UDP TCP ports.
Yeah, for you, Mark.
For Mark, yeah.
Yeah.
You said that like, how well do you know Mark?
Not very well at all. No. I just remembered the name because I've got a good memory.
Good memory, yeah.
So I think, yeah.
You didn't send a picture in there?
No. Okay. Send a picture of his wife.
You can't say that, man.
I'm sorry, no, I it was all made up. That was all just complete lie, fabrication. But I think on that note, guys, I'm going to wrap up this podcast unless anyone's got anything they want to add.
Right, done my bit.
Okay, then, based on that, then. Cheers, guys.
Bye. Take it.
IT Idiots is sponsored by UK2.net, the UK's largest web hosting provider. With domains from just £1.99 and web hosting from just 40p a day, visit itidiots.uk2.net for weekly offers. Get your piece of the internet at uk2.net.
He cried himself to sleep tonight on his huge pillow.